Well, I mean, actually, this brings me to one of the things I've been hoping to talk to you about for the longest time. So I think there's a part of you that finds you've always been very gracious about it and welcoming, but finds my liberalism a bit paradoxical.
No, I don't. Look, I don't. I understand the catastrophe of the Pareto distribution. I don't like it. You know, there is this proclivity for capital to accrue in the hands of smaller and smaller numbers of people. It isn't just capital, it's all goods. You get this terrible problem of distribution that's like a natural law. And the fact that people object to that is completely unsurprising. And the fact that if it goes unchecked, it destroys societies is, I don't think that's a hypothesis. That's demonstrably self-evident. So I don't find, I especially don't find the concern, the compassionate concern for working class people and their well-being the least bit incomprehensible. It's the solutions that are the problem. It's like, well, what should the solutions be? And well, that's where things get very, very complicated. It's not.
Well, perfect. And I'm sorry if I implied something that it wasn't even my perception. I think you are, to an extent, a conservative, but I find you, if I listen to you, it's not a simple kind of conservatism.
I'm a conservative for the same reason you are. You already pointed out, like, if you're a social scientist and you don't understand the law of unintended consequences, you are not a very good social scientist. I learned from my clinical research and from studying clinical research for so long and publishing it too, is that you think your intervention is going to do what you think it's going to do, but it isn't. It's going to do something else. And you have to build in, if you have an intervention that you think is going to have beneficial results, you have to build in an assessment to see if it has those results. And like, I talked to the woman who headed it was done in Cambridge, but in Massachusetts. It was a longitudinal study of antisocial children, the first longitudinal study. It was done in a working class neighborhood just outside of Cambridge. I used to live there and I can't remember the name at the moment, but in any case, this team intervened with kids that were likely to have they came from broken homes, broken neighborhoods, antisocial neighborhoods. This was done in the 1930s. And they intervened at the level of the child and at the level of the teachers and at the level of the parents, and ran this multiple year project to reduce risk for negative outcomes among this population, randomly assigned participants to groups, and by all accounts from the participants, the children, the parents, the teachers, and the professionals who were running the investigation, it was a resounding success. They looked at the results and the intervention group did worse on virtually every outcome measure. And they figured out later that the reason for that likely was that they took the antisocial kids and grouped them together in summer camp. They took them out of the city to put them in camp. They thought that would be a good intervention, but grouping them together seemed to produce a competition for antisocial behavior, and it overwhelmed all of the other interventions. That was Joan McCord, famous study. And I talked to Joan McCord a lot about that. But you see that all over the intervention literature, is it's very hard to fix. It's very hard to define a problem correctly. It's very hard to define to develop an intervention that addresses that problem and only that problem, and then it's very hard to get the intervention to do what you want it to. And that's what makes me conservative to the degree that I am. So,
yep. No, I think that's incredibly wise. I would add one thing to your list. It's not just that it's hard to get an intervention to do what you want it to do. It is that it is hard to get it to do what you want it to do, and at scale, these things also tend to evolve. So even
yes,
if you did
exactly
manage to
sure.
solve, right. And so the problem of unintended consequences, coupled with the problem of perverse incentives and therefore bad policy that is effectively corruption, is a very frightening problem. And so I do think we're caught in a basically damned if you do, damned if you don't scenario. We can't stay here. And, you know, I agree with you, social media, for lack of a better term for it, is going to dwarf the printing press for various reasons. Some of them because it's so easy,
yeah,
but also because it's of a fundamentally different nature, right? When you're reading a book, it may be that somebody writes something that's bad for you to absorb, but you know you're reading a book because the experience of it, the perception of it is of a book. Whereas social media increasingly fools the mind into, you know, the interaction you and I are having is more or less a face-to-face interaction. But a lot of interactions that look like face-to-face interactions don't have these characteristics. And at best, the impact on the mind is arbitrary. So, you know, we're watching things like amplifiers of threat. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this goes back to the thing we were discussing earlier.
But if look, with Twitter, here's a good example of unintended consequences. It's like, what don't we know? Okay, we don't know what regulates human communication. We know that if you restrict the bandwidth, people don't understand each other as well. But we don't know how communication functions. It's too complicated. Okay, so we absolutely don't know what happens to communication at a large scale when you restrict people to 140 or 280 characters and then put them in a network of millions of other people. We have no idea. And it could be that you tremendously bias the discourse towards impulsive anger. It looks like that if you look at Twitter. I mean, and because it's 140 or 280 characters, you can whip something off very quickly. And so it's almost as if the technology is implicitly commanding you to be impulsively aggressive. And then we don't know what it means when only those people who are motivated to be impulsively aggressive that day are those that are communicating. And then when you only see those communications, even though, you know, 10,000 people might read your tweet, only 100 who are irritated for some reason respond. We don't know any of that. And we completely underestimate the power of the technology because it looks harmless. It just sits there on your phone and doesn't do anything. And so, you know, God only knows what kind of Tower of Babel that is. So,
right. And not only that, but the fact that the algorithm changes and we don't get any notice of it, not only do we not have access to whatever the algorithm's content is, but we don't know when it changes, mm-hmm. which means it's impossible for us to even track the impact of our own behavior because we can't run a controlled experiment.
Right. It's like predicting the stock market. It's an illusion that you're dealing with the same thing every day. It's complete illusion. Right. And then, of course, we don't know, you know, the algorithms increasingly have a life of their own and increasingly they're governed by artificial intelligence. And it derives implications that we don't even understand. And as you pointed out, it all changes so quickly that we can't keep up with it in any event. So, yes. So,
right. So then the conversation, and I'm certain it's going to take, multiple tries for us to get there. Hopefully we'll have the opportunity for multiple discussions. But the question is, all right, you're a conservative, but you're a wise conservative that understands the importance of liberalism, understands the necessity of tension between the desire not to mess things up with unintended consequences and the desire to solve problems that are actually solvable. And I would argue the necessity to solve certain problems, which will be fatal if we don't solve them.